Hello friends, thanks for joining me today. Once again, I am available here to share my experience and implementation for one of the important topic, scheduler. I made this video in a way so that it is extremely easy to understand and implement scheduler into your project. We are going to discuss about quad scheduler using Spring Boot. Friends, if you are new to the channel, then please subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon so that you will get early notification. Also, like, comment and share videos. Now, as we already talked a lot, let's start our discussion. So friends, what we'll do is, first we'll try to understand what is scheduler. So if you worked on Unix or Windows system, then you might be aware of, in Unix there is a concept called cron job, and on Windows there is a concept called task scheduler. So basically what these cron job or task scheduler do is, it will allow you to schedule a job for a particular time. Also, it will give you flexibility where you can repeat your job in some interval, whatever interval you want, like every minute, every second, every one day, first week of month. All these sorts of flexibility is there in those jobs. Similarly, how these things can be done in Java, that's what we are going to understand. Let's say same feature we want in our application, not on OS level, but on application level, if you want some scheduler feature, how we are going to implement that, that's what we are going to understand. And for that, for what we need to understand is, first we need to understand what is scheduler. So scheduler is very similar to cron job or task scheduler. Scheduler means you want to execute something at a particular time. Okay, so you want to schedule something, correct? So you want to execute something at a particular time, at a defined time, and within scheduler you have different options. So you wanted to leverage those options, like you wanted to start executing some job from tomorrow, and then you want to keep it repeating for every 10 minutes, for every 1 hour, or for every day, correct? And that can be like infinitely, or that can be like you just want to execute that piece of code only 10 iterations starting from that particular time. So these all are scheduler. So scheduler means basically you want to execute something at a defined time, okay? And that's what we are going to discuss in this particular video. What is quad scheduler? We need to understand. So scheduler is something which I have already explained. Now, by having this logical view of scheduler into your mind, so you can implement your own code for scheduler. But again, for implementing that code, it will take a lot of time, correct? And you may always have a chance to miss the best practices, or you cannot go for all the features. Or even let's say you are going with all these best practices, all the features, then it may take a lot of time, correct? So why not we can use something which is in industry practice and it is easily available. So quad scheduler is an API from Apache, is a open source job scheduling library that can be integrated within virtually any Java application. Quad is freely usable, licensed under Apache 2.4 license. So we can make use of quad scheduler. Now this is one thing where you can make use of quad scheduler. Now by using a Spring Boot, it makes more easy, because a Spring Boot, what it has done, it has implemented quad scheduler and given a wrapper class on top of that, which is very easy to use. And that's why what we are going to do is, we will go with quad scheduler using Spring Boot. Okay, I would highly recommend to go for documentation of quad scheduler. So there can be two documentation where you can refer for quad scheduler. One is Spring Boot and another is quad scheduler. So I would recommend to directly go to the quad scheduler. Actually, Spring Boot also implemented the same quad scheduler. Only the thing is, by using Spring Boot, you will get a wrapper sort of thing, which is something on top of the actual quad scheduler. So what you have to do is you have to go for quad cedular URL, and then these are the steps that you have to follow in order to go for a cookbook. So what is cookbook is there you can find a small sample code for different scenario, okay, which is going to help you. Like if let's say you want to understand how to create a job detail or how to create a trigger, so those small pieces you can find over there, okay, so which is very easy to understand. Spring Boot has implementation of quad scheduler in a way which is very simple to incorporate into your project using quad starter. So as we all know, Spring Boot is all about a starter. So you just have to include a starter of quad and you are all set to implement the quad implementation. Also, in application.properties, there are some changes that you have to do for quad. So these are the some well-known properties which you need to define into your application.properties. So I have listed the main one, whereas there are a couple of others as well, which I have given a reference in the same slide. So first one is whether you want to start your scheduler automatically or not. So I don't want in my case, because if I'll walk you through the code, then I'll explain you. Actually, I have started my quad scheduler using my post construct method of a service class. And quad job store type. So basically you have option like you can define memory store type also. So in my case, I'll go for a database JDBC. spring.qual.property. So this property is where you can see something like spring.qual.properties.star. So basically this explains properties from the actual quad scheduler. Whatever properties we have seen, like spring.qual.auto-startup, that belongs to Spring Boot. So basically they have customized how to behave quad scheduler within Spring Boot, and for that you have different options available which you can find in Spring Boot Commons properties. So these are the properties very much related to Spring Boot to handle your quad within Spring Boot. However, spring.qual.properties, these are the generic properties which is very much associated with quad only, okay. So one of the important scheduler properties is you have to define thread count. So basically what is the meaning of thread count? So basically scheduler is a sort of container, okay, and this parameter defines how many thread is going to run at any point of time, so that these many threads can handle these many concurrent jobs. So if you have defined 5 thread count, so it means you can run 5 concurrent jobs at the same time. For the specific properties, you can find over this based upon this link. Like you have to go for call scheduler and then go for docs or documentation, and then go for select latest stable release from the left panel on right hand side, select configuration from available documentation type. So what I'll do is I'll just walk you through, I'll just go to this quad scheduler once and then you can take a look. So this is a quad website where you can go for documentation from here, or you can go from docs as well. When you will click documentation, you have different release option over here. So you can select any, but what I would recommend is go for latest stable release. So this is the one, and now you have option for Java doc, so quick start guide. So all these are important. So what I would recommend is go for cookbook at least, and then go for configuration to see what are the properties that you can set it up, okay. Java doc is also very important. Quick start guide is something where they have explained like how to create a different object and how to get your project started, okay, so that you can go over there. If you are using H2 database and DDL to create a schema at runtime, then Spring will create a schema for Quark at runtime itself. But if you are using DB like MySQL, Oracle, etc., then either you can create Quark schema by yourself into the database or point a schema SQL file from application.properties of Spring Boot. So this is the property which you can make use and point your schema.sql, or you can directly connect to your MySQL DB or Oracle DB and create all the table using SQL query. Okay, so for different database, these are the links from where you can get all the table schema which you need for Quark. In this picture, what I'm trying to explain is, I'm just trying to show how internally, logically, scheduler will look like. So basically, here there are three objects: scheduler, job, and trigger. So job is something where you have explained your job details, like which portion of code you want to execute. That those things you will explain in job, with proper name and identity and all. Trigger is something where you will explain like how you want to trigger your job. Means, what is the start time, what will be the counter, means how many time you want to execute that job, and what would be the gap, and all those details will be explained in trigger. And job and trigger will have the mapping. So basically, and scheduler will be a container. So whenever a time will reach for trigger to execute your job, so what scheduler is going to do is, scheduler will make a call to trigger, and trigger will make use of job to execute your job. Okay, this is how it is going to behave. We are going to see this practically in our practical session. So here, what I have done is, I have explained the two main objects which you need in order to schedule your job. One is job detail and another is trigger. As I explained in my last slide, trigger is something related to the timestamp, and job is something like what exactly you want to execute. So here you can see a job builder is a builder class which is used to get you a job detail. So by using job builder, you can supply your job class which you want to call when this trigger is going to execute. So my job.class is a job which job is going to execute at defined time of the trigger. So again, with identity you have to give a unique name and a group name. So basically, name should be always Unix within a group. So if let's say you have a group, let's say group G1, then in that G1 group you can have n number of job name, but those job name needs to be Unix. Basically, you have to think of job name and group name as the primary key of the job detail. What is the meaning of storability means, once all the execution of this job, meaning is, let's say you have set 10 iterations to execute, and all those 10 iterations completed by this parameter, what does it mean is, it is going to clean up that job from the database. If you will make it true, then it will keep that job into the database, and this is saved set job data. So basically, this is the data map which will be available to your job when trigger happens to this job. So which you will more able to understand when we'll go through the practical. Trigger is something where you are going to get a new trigger using trigger builder, a builder class. So again, you have to go for name and group, very similar to job. And here you have to define at what particular time it has to start, and with schedule, like how many iteration, what will be the difference between different iteration, all those things you need to define over here. Okay, zone date time. So basically, here in this case, when you are going to schedule your trigger, then you have to give a date. But in what, why we are going for zone date time? Because along with date, we have flexibility for different zones also. So, you know, like if you want to execute job, some job at this IST time, or if you want to execute some job at this EST time, Eastern time zone, or CST time, okay, or GMT time, whatever time zone. So that's why we are going to use zone date time, which anyway I'm going to explain in the practical. So guys, I believe this slide explanation will give you some confidence. So what now we are going to do is, let's go to the system and try to understand this using practical. Okay, so let's go to the system. Okay friends, so what we have to do here is, now we are going to create a quad scheduler project. For quad scheduler, what are the dependencies that you need and how to create the project, that I am going to showcase you. So first thing is, you just have to go for a spring initializer, and the first link will come something like start.spring.io. That's what you have to click, and then this is what you will get, where you have option to select what type of project you are going with. So in my case, I'm going with Maven project, and the language which I'm using is Java, and the version is the latest stable release. So we will go with 2.4.5, and here you have to go for group, artifact, and then name and the description, like demo project for a Spring Boot Quarch, and the package name and packaging selection. So that will be jar only and Java. So in my case, I'll go with 8, and then dependencies, what we have to go with is, so is web anyway you need, so spring web, and then you need Quarch as well, and you need data JPA for database related thing, and finally we can have dev tool also, so that in case we are doing any change in project, automatically it restart the container. So these are the four dependencies that we need, in which three are a starter and one is dev tool. So once you are done with all this, then go for generate, and finally you will get a zip file. You just have to unzip that, and then you have to import that project into your workspace. So in my case, I already imported that project into my workspace, that is quad scheduler. So basically in your case also, what you can do is, you just have to go for import. You will give a right click over here and then go for import. Okay. And wherever you have unzipped your project, just go to that location after selecting existing Maven project. So this is the Maven project. So you have to select existing Maven project. Then next, then go for the path where you have unzipped your zip file, downloaded zip file. Go to that place and then import that particular project. Once you are done with that, then it will take 1 or 2 minutes, and finally your Spring Quarch project will come into your workspace. Now in our case, what we have defined is for giving demo on Quarch scheduler, what I have done is, let's consider we are a fruit seller who is selling two fruits right now. One is apple and another is orange. Okay, so this is a class which represents fruit. So here we have only one property, that is fruit name. Fruit ID is something which is primary and will be automatically generated. So this, you know, like, because we have this at entity, because we are using data JPA, and this ID means it's a primary key, fruit ID, and generated value, which means we don't want to keep track of generation of unique ID. It has to be taken care by the Spring Data JPA. That's why we are using generated value. Okay, so this is your fruit class. Now, as I said, we are a fruit seller dealing with two main fruits, like the apple and orange. So what we are doing here is, we are selling fruits. Okay, so there would be options like, first you have to add fruits into your repository. Okay, so and then you have option to sell your fruit. So then you have to delete that fruit from your repository, and you will have option to fetch all your fruits also, so that you can see how many fruits are there. You have option to count your fruits by fruit name also. So you can make a API call and see how many apples are there or how many orange are there. So for dealing with all those things, we have defined different methods in our service class. So this is our entity, and for this entity we have a repository already defined, that is fruits repo. So if you will see here, then we have a method. Actually by default font by fruit name is not there. Actually we have defined a signature for that method. Implementation will be given by Spring Boot Data JPA at the runtime. So what we are doing here is count by fruit name. So once we'll get the fruit name, let's say apple or orange, then we'll get count for that particular fruit. It's how many apple are there or how many orange are there. And this is where we want unique fruit in our container or repository. So select distinct fruit name. So right now we are handling only apple orange, so you will get two fruit name only, like apple and orange. If let's say tomorrow you are going with some other fruit, like let's say banana, then in that case you will get three. So like that it is going to return you. So we are using native query, that is this query is exactly same as SQL. If you want proper video on Spring Data JPA, how to deal with database for query and all those things, then please comment on below so that I can make a video on Spring Data JPA. Okay, so we are done with fruit and fruit repo. Then we have a service class. So this is a service class, and in this service class we have auto-wired our repository, because by using fruit repository we are going to make transaction or make call to fruit. Okay, we are dealing with fruit. So this is the first method where we are saving fruit into the repository or database. So someone has to call by giving a fruit object, and then we are saving that fruit into database and returning the same persisted fruit. So basically at this, when you are going to save, you will not have ID, because that ID will be automatically generated. So the Spring Data JPA is going to generate that fruit ID, and then it will be saved into the database. But when database, you will get this saved fruit from the database, it will have that ID also. So along with fruit name, you will have fruit ID, which has been provided by Spring Data JPA. So the same is going to be returned, the same fruit object. Okay. Now the next method is find all fruit. So basically this is a default method of fruit repository which we are making use of, fruit repo dot find all, which will give all the fruit details. So basically let's say you have 4 apple and 3 oranges, so you will get 7 object. So basically 4 apple object and 3 orange object in the list of fruit. Okay, so this is what find all fruits. And then we have another method which says delete fruit. So in this, first we have to find fruit by ID. So we are making use of find by ID, which is a default method available. Now by making use of fruit ID, we are making a call to our repository to get fruit by ID. And this will return optional. Optional is a container type. So what we are doing is, first we are checking whether any fruit is present or not. So fruit ID is a primary key, so it will return only one. So we are just checking whether fruit is present or not. If it is present, then we are just deleting that fruit. So we have to make a call fruit.get to get exact object from optional data type. This method count by fruit name is where client has to give the fruit name, and it will give you total count of that particular fruit. So if you will see, then in a fruit repo we have defined count by fruit name. So basically we just have to give a signature for that count by fruit name. So basically this needs to be exactly same whatever name you have defined for fruit property. So if you will see fruit name, that's the property. So what we are doing here is fruit name, first letter needs to be capital and then you can define your own method. So implementation will be provided by Spring Data JPA. You just have to send the fruit name and it will return you total number of count by using fruit name. Now come to controller class. In controller class, we have a different API available. So one is slash fruits, with that is post mapping. So in this, basically client has to send fruit data and that will be saved into the database, and in return we are going to send response entity with the saved fruit. Okay, similarly in the get mapping of fruits, it is going to return all the fruits what are available into the database. In fruits count by name, so basically this API is going to give total count by name. So let's say someone is sending by giving apple, then it will give total count of apple. If someone is sending by using orange, then it will give total count of orange. At last, we have an API available for deletion as well. Basically, we have delete mapping where someone has to send fruit ID and we are going to delete that fruit by using the fruit ID. So that's what. So right now we are a fruit seller, and what we are doing is we are adding fruits into our database, we are deleting. So we have to add fruit into our repository. Now as we are selling our fruit, we have to delete that fruit from our repository database. And now the requirement is, let's say we are running business on a daily basis, by evening I just want total count of all of these fruits, how many available, like how many available apple is there, how many available orange is there by end of daily. We just want this detail so that I can order for next day. So we need to have a scheduler sort of thing which can simply run at that particular job, which can run at a particular time, let's say 9 p.m. and it just send us like how many apple available or how many orange available. So we are going to define that particular scheduler now. Okay, so what are the changes that we have to do in order to get that scheduler running into our system, that we have to understand.
Now let's start the Spring Boot, and we can create fruit. Okay, so post method, and this will be the URL, and in body we have to go for fruit object. So this will be the object. So we need only fruit name. Fruit ID will be auto generated. Fruit name. Apple. Just send it. This got created. Now let's create 8 apple. Eight apple got created. Now we'll create orange. So we'll create 5 orange. Okay, so we are done with all this creation. So basically for create any fruit, what we need to do, we have to make a post call to localhost 8080 slash fruit, and then we have to select the body, and data type will be raw and it will be JSON format. Okay, here we have to give data in the JSON format. Now we can make use of get to get all fruit. So you can see we have all the fruits over here. If we want to delete any fruit, what we have to do is we just have to go for delete mapping and then slash fruit ID. So let's say 12, then we are good to delete this fruit. Okay, so we are done with data creation of fruit. Now we will proceed further.
Okay guys, so let me walk you through my application dot properties. Spring.data source. Username and the password will be admin, so that I kept it for my SQ database. This will be driver for SQ database. and again data source URL. I'm not using in-memory database. I will be using H2 database within a file. So I already created quas.db, or so you just have to have this path. Quas.db will be automatically created in this particular path. Okay. And this console enabled, basically we want H2 database to be accessible on browser. So H2 console enabled is true. So SQL, so basically JPFO SQL. This will allow us to get SQL query logging on console. And this is Hibernate DDL, DDL auto update. So basically at the runtime, it is going to create table into database. You need not to create table explicitly. It will be done at the runtime itself. Also, benefit of update is at the time of container startup, it is not going to first drop your table and then create. Basically, always it is going to update. In the first time, obviously, it is going to create the table, and next time onwards, it is going to update, but it is not going to drop your table. So that's the benefit of using update. Now, these are the parameters that I'm using for quas. So string.quas JavaScript type is JDBC, and this is something which explains about how many thread you want into your quas container. So if it is 5, then it means you can concurrently execute 5 jobs. So this totally depends upon your requirement. Okay. So now what we will do is, again, this is the latest release of Spring. So in this Spring, quas table will not be created automatically at the container startup. So what we will do is, we will first create those table into our database, and then we will start developing code for quas scheduler. So all those quas schema of SQL, I'm going to provide into the description of this video. So let's start it first. So this got started. Let me access my H2 database. So okay, so here you can see these table already I have created. How I have created? By using quas.sql. quas.sql. So here all the tables exist. So I'm going to attach this in the description. Okay. So now what we'll do is, we'll go for shut down this application, and then we are going to go for scheduler. So basically we want to execute some scheduled job at some particular time, at a defined time, correct? So there are a couple of things that you need to understand. So once you have any class of type org.quas.job with execute method implemented over there, okay, and the same class is getting used in job detail. So basically job detail is related to when you are going to schedule, then you need job detail. So once you will have any class which implements org.quas.job with execute method in it, and same class is getting used in job detail, then trigger execute method of that particular class. Okay, so that we are going to see. So first thing is, you need any class which is going to implement quas.job, org.quas.job. So let me create that class. So I am in scheduler, okay, package. I'll create a class called scheduled job. This is scheduled job, and I want this to be managed by my Spring container. Only the thing is, I'll not go for implementation of job, rather I will use quas job bean, because quas job bean is a subclass of org.quas.job. So here, Here, this execute internal is a method which will make call to execute method of org.quas.job on behalf of you. So basically, we will we'll use this class in our job details so that execute internal method will be called. Now from context, you can get whole lot of detail. So this is a Spring managed class. So you will have access to all the components of your project. So you just auto-wire and use it. Another thing is, if let's say you want to get some specific data into this method, then that can also be accessible. At the time of setting up your job detail, you can send those data using job data map, so which we are going to discuss very soon. So this is the first method that you have to do. Now what next? In order to schedule your job, you have to define two objects. One is job detail and another is trigger. And those job detail and trigger will be used with scheduler. Okay, so scheduler is going to make use of that job detail and trigger to execute at a particular scheduled time. Okay, and again, for defining your job detail, you need some details, like you need job name, job group, you need what will be the starting time, how many times you want to execute that particular job, and also you need what would be the duration or gap between two executions. Those things you need. So for those sort of data, let's create a class so that when client will schedule something, then that object will be needed, which will have all the information about job name, job group, start time and all. So let's create that class. So again here, I'll create something like job data. And okay, so we have created all these property into this job data, like job name, job group, start time. And data type of this start time is local date time. So basically, we need the date along with time. And also we can format it something like JSON format, and pattern we can define here, like in which pattern we need the data and in which pattern the data will be sent to the client. So we need year, month, date, and then hour, minute, second. Okay, let's create getter and setter method. Okay, we are done. Now two things are done. One is scheduled job, another is job data. Now we are all set to create our schedule method. So let's create a schedule method in service class. So public will not return anything in this case. Void schedule, and client has to send job data. Okay, and what we need to do is, first we need to extract all the data, whatever we need to schedule our job. So string job name is equal to data dot get job name, string job group is equal to data dot get job group, and then we need int counter, that is number of time you want your job to be executed, that is data dot get counter int gap duration. That is duration between two job, data dot get gap duration, and the finally zone date time we need. Zone date time. So actually, I don't want to handle this job based upon only date and time. I also want to handle using different zones. So you can mention the time zone at which you want to execute that particular job. So in that case, I am just setting it up with some static value. However, you can ask the same value from your client as well. So what I'll do is I'll go for zone date time dot off, and here you can go with data dot get local date time, that is the start time. And then what zone ID we need, zone ID dot off, here we have to give ID. So from where you can get this zone ID, simply go to Google and go for zone ID in Java, go to Oracle documentation, and here you have different zone ID. Like for IST, Indian, for IST, I can go with IST Asia Kolkata. This parameter I can use. Similarly, for EST, you can make use of America / New York. Okay, so we are set with all of these things. Now what we have to do is go for job detail. Job detail we need, so is equal to, now there is a class job builder class which we can make use. Here you have to go with new job and then which particular class you want to execute. So basically that class should be a type of org.quad.job. So that's what we have created here, scheduled job. Quad job being already a subclass of org.quad.job. So we'll make use of scheduled job. Go to the service dot class dot with identity. So we'll go with name of this job, job name and job group, which looks good. Now with description, if we want, we can go with description, but that's okay if we don't want to. And then if you want to give some data map which can be accessed in your scheduled job execute internal method, this method, if you want to set some data map, that can also be done. So what we'll do is we'll set some data map. Let's go for that. Job data map, new job data map, data map dot put. So this is overloaded method with different type of data that it can accept. So what we'll do is we'll just go for a string key and a string value. So something like this, and here we'll go for, this is just for demo. Okay, and similarly you also have option to put object also. Only the thing is this object needs to be serialized. You cannot simply use any object, that needs to be serialized. Okay, so that's what you have to make sure. Okay, so now we'll go with, let's see, using job data, and here we'll go with data map, and then what else we can go with, I believe let's go for build. Okay, so job detail is ready. Now what we'll do is let's go for trigger is equal to, trigger builder class is there, so we'll go with trigger builder, and then we will call new trigger dot, and we will define with identity. Again, for this trigger we can define trigger name with identity. So again, it's a overloaded method. We will use the same one. Job name and job group, keep it same to make the thing simple. Okay, now start at. So here it will use date. So what we'll do is date dot from, and then we just have to go for instant. So here we'll go with zone date time dot to instant. Simple. Now dot with schedule. What will be the schedule? So we'll go with simple schedule builder dot simple schedule dot. Here you have different options. So what we'll do is in my case I'll go with interval in minutes. Okay, but you can use any of this overloaded method, and there are different types of method also. So with interval in minutes, so that will be duration between two job, and then what we'll do is then we will go with repeat count. So that will be the counter, and finally dot build. It is going to return us a trigger object. Now we are good with detail and trigger, job detail and trigger. So job detail will have information about your job, and trigger will have all the information about the timing. Now we have to use these two objects to create a schedule. So what we will do is, so how to get a schedule? So let's import scheduler. So this guy scheduler and quad scheduler, we just auto wired scheduler only. And one more thing we have to do is, if you will see application.properties, let me show you the application.properties. So here we have to go with spring pause auto startup false. So we don't want to auto start our pause as soon as container starts. I will explicitly start it from my service class. So what I have done here is I have defined post construct. So after this instance initialization, container is going to call start pause scheduler dot start, and similarly before destroying the container, Spring Boot will call pause scheduler dot shutdown. So we are good over here. So this is a very important thing. Now what we have to do is scheduler pause scheduler dot schedule. In schedule we just need to give detail and trigger, and it will throw. So just go with try and catch. Done. So we are all set with our schedule. Now let's create one API over here. We'll go with post mapping, and here that will be schedule, and this will be void only, and schedule request body, and we need job data. Data, and what we need to global schedule. Done. Return, and this will be okay. The 200 response we are going to send. simple. Schedule is done. This is done. Now you can see this guy is will make a call to service. This job, we are good with job detail. We are good with trigger, and then we are making a call to schedule job. Okay. So simple schedule builder is something like here you can see a start at. So whatever time we will give from that particular time, this job will start executing, and then with schedule, like between how many iterations that you can give and what will be the difference between those iterations, that also will be given by using gap duration. Okay. So we are good. Now schedule job also, you can see you just have to extend for job win, and I have used component. Why? Because I just want it to be managed by Spring. Okay, Spring container. Okay, so now what I'll do is I'll just get something over here. So context dot get merge job data. And actually, whatever we have set in job detail, those job data map will be accessed over here. We just have to assign a statement to the node. Okay. Now what we will do is we'll go with for string p and merge job data dot get key. And then merge job data dot get key. So that's what we are going to print from scheduled job. Okay, let's save it. Job data is very clear. Okay, and this is very clear. Now let's start it. Save all. Okay, this is started. Now we are in Postman, and what we will do is we'll make a post call to this URL. From drop down we have to select post and this schedule, and then we have to select body, and from there we have to select raw and then JSON, and this counter will be two time we want, and gap duration will be one, and one, that is 1 minute. The start time will be, right now it is 7:28 p.m. so what I'll do is 12 plus 7 19, then 28, so I'll go with 20:30, and then 00, that will be job name, and that will be job name. Let's go with job name and group name. Let's send this and see. So this got saved. Now how to show that? So just go to your H2 database and go to see that quad job details. You have this here. Job name, why this is default? Okay, anyway, here you have quad trigger. Quad simple trigger, go over here, you can find it. Job 1 and default. So here you can see from scheduled job, this is just for demo. At 7:30 p.m. it got executed. So basically we have given how many counter has given. We have supplied 2 counter. So after 7:30 it is going to repeat 2 more times. Okay, and there will be 1 minute difference. So we'll see that. So in total 3 time it is going to execute. Okay, this schedule. So let's see. Okay, so group name came as default because this is the correct parameter name, job group. We'll go with that and then we'll see. So right now it executed one more time at 7:31 p.m. Now you can see at 7:32 it got executed, and after that those data will be deleted from the database. I think that will be there because we did not set. Oh, that got deleted. If you want to do it explicitly, then you have to set one parameter into the job detail. Okay, let me show you. Dot set store durably. So store durably, if it is false, then it after execution of complete execution of this job, the data will be getting out from the database. If it is set durably is true, then what does it mean is it is going to keep your job into the database. So what we want is, in most of the cases, as soon as this job execution completes, we want to delete that job from the database. So that's why we always set this to false. By default it is false only. Okay, so we are good with this. Now what we need to understand is, if let's say someone wants to understand how many job is scheduled right now, so one thing is you simply make a call by using pod scheduler to get all the job details. Okay, but something like, you know, pod scheduler dot from get job key. So first you have to get all the job keys, and then by using those job keys you will have option to get all the job details, like by using job name and job group. Those details you can give it to the client, but in our case we don't want to go with that. So basically what we can do is, in order to handle scheduler, because scheduler has their own data manipulation, okay, so what we can have is, we will have our own table created to maintain the reference of schedule. Okay, as soon as data schedule data will be deleted, then we are going to delete data from our reference table also. Even after completion of job execution, we have to delete job detail from our reference table. Okay, so now as we talked, this scheduled job will execute based upon previous execution. Whatever time you have defined at that time, it is going to execute. So what now we will do is, basically whenever this scheduled job is going to execute, we are going to get the count of fruits. How many apple are there or how many orange are there, those things we want to get. So what we can do is, we will directly make use of repository over here. Or you can define a method in your service class, and that's what you can call from here as well. But what I am doing right now is, I'll simply auto-wire the repository. And then from fruit repo dot find unique fruit name. So let's go for control 1 and assign a statement to fruit name. Okay, so now what we will do is, we'll iterate it. So and then we'll count each fruit. So again we'll make a call to fruit repo dot count by fruit name. It will give us count. So the fruit will be
count is whatever count you will get. So let's execute it. So right now, once again come to postman, we'll go for schedule, and then in this case, let's make the counter to zero, so that we want to execute only once at the time of the start time. And right now time is 1:26, so I'll go for 13:27. Then let's, and first we have to start it. If it is not started, okay, it is started now. Go for 1:28. Okay, now our job is going to execute only once at 1:28, and it will give us the fruit name and the fruit count. Okay, that's what we discussed earlier. Like on daily evening, we need all the fruit count so that next day we can order. So we need some sort of this scheduler. Okay, so now you can see this is fruit apple and count is 8. And this is fruit orange, count is 5. So this is going to help us to get information like how many things we have to order for tomorrow. So this sort of schedule you can do in your project also. So that's what is very important. Now next, what we need to understand is sometimes we already gone through how to schedule a job. But let's say if you want to get information, what are the jobs available right now and what are the schedule time, duration, counter, all those information you need. Like how many jobs are there right now in scheduler. Okay, so that is one thing. Another thing is you need to get option where you will give option to the client to delete the existing job also. So that is second thing. So what I would recommend is there is option to fetch these job details from calls table itself. But we will not go with that option. What we will do is we will create our own reference table which will have all the detail of job. So when we are scheduling a job, we will save job detail into our reference table also, so that when someone wants to view how many jobs are there in the scheduler right now, we can show it from our reference table rather than going for quad table. So quad table we will not touch at all. Okay, what we will do is we will maintain our reference job table in order to give details of like right now how many jobs are there, and then when there is an option to delete scheduled job, then we are going to delete job from our reference table also. Only the problem is when there is completion of any job which is already scheduled, then how you are going to delete job from your reference table. So there we will make use of scheduler listener. So that's what we are going to discuss next. Okay, so stay tuned.
Okay, so now what we will do is we will create a reference table where we will save all job details. Okay, so let's go for that. First stop the service. Okay, now here what we will do is we will go for a class. Basically that will be a entity class, so better to go for entity itself. Okay, so I'll just create a class. So name will be so schedule info will have all the information of your scheduler, like job name, job group, and what is the start time, what will be the counter, all those information will be there in this. Okay, so whatever you are going to save into your scheduler, same information you are going to save into your scheduled info. And if you want to show like how many scheduler job is right now in scheduler, then you will fetch the data from this table rather than going for your quad scheduler. You can go for this reference table. Okay, so what are other property which we need is, we'll just go for our REST service where we have this schedule. So now we need all of these. So we need job name, job group, counter, gap duration, and local date and time. Okay, so better to go for job data itself. Okay. So this is job name, job group, and the local date, time, counter, and gap duration. These are the enough information that we need in a reference table of our scheduler. Okay, so let's go and go for alt as getter and setter. So generate getter and setter. Done. And this is entity class, and ID is the primary key, which is auto generated. Now what you have to do is, when someone is going to schedule the job, at that time itself you have to save that job detail into your reference table. So schedule info is an entity class, so let's generate repository for that. Okay, so we'll go here. And we will add crude repository. This would be an interface. What we will do is, we will just go for scheduled info repo. Auto wire it. And whenever you are scheduling the job, just try to save schedule info using schedule info repo as well. So what we will do is, first create scheduled info. Okay, so our scheduled info is ready. As soon as we are going to set this, we have to call schedule info repo dot save, and we are going to save schedule info as well. So this is great. So whenever we will schedule our quad job, we will save that job related info into our scheduled info reference table. Also, try to make this job name as a unique key. Okay, this is long. Okay, now we are good. Now only the thing that you have to understand is, when someone is scheduling job, then it is scheduled in scheduler, and you are saving a reference into your reference table, that is scheduled info. Now when someone is deleting that job, then you have to give option to delete it from your schedule info table also. One thing. Another thing is, once this job scheduler job execution is completed, then automatically call scheduler will remove those details from their database, from their table. So same thing you need to do also. So how to achieve that? Okay, so first I'll show you how same scheduled info data is going to saved into scheduled info table. Okay, so let's start this. I'm going to execute it at around 14. Okay, and only at once start time it will execute. We'll just send it. So it is done. Now if you will go to H2 console, you can find quad job detail is there, even pause triggered is there. Now go to schedule info,
schedule info is there. Job group come as null. Let me check that. Okay, maybe I am using wrong parameter, their group name. So I have to change this to job group. Okay, let me see what is the parameter. So this already executed. And once the execution is done, if you will see, then data is cleaned up from this table. Even it is cleaned up from job details. But still data is there in the schedule info. Correct? So how to deal with that? So basically we need to have a listener for that. So how to get the listener? Let me show you. Also, whenever we are sending data, so this should be, what should be the name? Let me see, job data and job group, that is the name. So we have to go with job group. Okay, so this is the correct name. So we have to go with this option. Now go here and create your own listener by extending scheduler listener. So my let's go for implement. So from org.quad we will go for scheduler listener. We will just implement that and we are going to override all unimplemented methods. Only the thing what we have to use is this trigger finalize. So basically whenever there will be a cleanup. So once your job execution is done, scheduler listener will make a call to this trigger finalize method. So we have to get trigger finalize thing. We have to get the data from here and then delete data from reference table using this method. Okay. Again, let's make it component. The Spring is going to manage it. And from here, trigger dot get job key. So we'll get the job key. And from here, let's auto add. You can make a call to service layer or auto wire repository of scheduled info directly over here. So scheduled info repo auto wire it and then we are going to make use in this method. So let's clean up after job execution. Okay. And here from job key. So go for control 1, job key, and from job key you can get job name and job group. So simply what you can do is find schedule info data by using job name, because job name is a unique field in your schedule info. So let's create it unique. unique is equal to true. Okay, job name, always try to save your job with a unique name. That's what you have to do when you are making call using Postman. Always this job name needs to be unique. That's what you have to make sure. Okay, so schedule info. In the schedule listener, what we have to do is, first we have to find reference data from the schedule info using job name. So what we'll do is job key dot get name. It will give us job name. So we'll go with control 1 and assign a statement to. Okay, here we can go with job name. We'll go with find by job name. So in repo class, so public schedule info find by job name string job name. So it will give us that particular record, scheduled info, from our reference table, this method. So what we will do is, we will just make a call to find by job name. And then go for control 1, assign it to a local variable. And then if not equal to null, then what we will do is, dot okay. So we are good over here. Right now, Quartz is not aware of my listener. So you have to set this listener somewhere. So where we will set this? In REST service, there is a method. There is a method which is post construct. So in post construct, we are initializing. We are starting our Quartz scheduler. So by using call scheduler, what you can do is, you can get scheduler manager and then add listener. So first thing what we will do is, we will just auto wire the listener, our listener. So what we will do is, my scheduler listener and auto wire it. And then call scheduler dot get listener manager dot add, and here you have overloaded method. So what we'll do is, we'll go for add scheduler listener, where we will use my scheduler listener. And then, so basically this listener is registered with now this pod scheduler. So whenever something is going to happen within scheduler, like whenever add job, schedule job, so method of my scheduler is going to be executed. But I don't want to track all those methods. Only the thing is, whenever cleanup is done, I just want to clean up in my reference table also. And that's why there is a method which will be called at the time of cleanup called trigger finalize. Same I am calling, and I am deleting my reference table as well. So now let's start this application and let's see. So I'll go to database first. So let me go for scheduled info. Okay, right now data is there. So what I'll do is, I'll just clean it. Okay, just go for clean. So clean is done. Now I'll go to postman and then I'll go for. So what is the time? 15:08. Okay. So this got scheduled. If now you will come here, you can see job group, job name, everything is there. And then if you will go for quads trigger, then we have quads trigger as well. If you will go for quads job detail, there we have quads job detail as well. So everything is in place. Now what we have to do is we just have to wait for some time so that our job execution will be done. And once the job execution will be done, then there will be a cleanup process. That also we have to see. Okay, let's wait for some time. Okay, so here you can see this job execution is there. And Apple has count 8 and Orange has count 5. So now what is happening is cleanup after job execution. That got executed. This guy. Listener, cleanup after job execution is executed. So let's see if data got deleted from our reference table. Go to H2 console. So it's got deleted from here, call job detail. Let me see for calls trigger. Calls trigger. Okay, nothing is there. Clear it. Go to schedule info and then run it. Here also nothing is there. So our listener is working fine. Now the second thing is, whenever someone wants to delete your job, or another option is you have to expose one API for viewing all the scheduled jobs. That is one thing. Second thing is you want to delete some specific job. So in that case, you have to send job name and job group, and by using that, someone can delete job from cost table as well as from your reference table. So first thing is, let's go for view all jobs. So let's stop it. And in the rest, so in the service class, this is your service class. Okay, so this is a method which we have created to get all job details. So basically, from schedule info repo, we'll just go for find all. It will send us iterable. By using iterator, what we'll do is we will iterate the data what we got it from the repository, and then we'll send final list by using this job. This is one thing. Now go for another method which will have option to delete. Now this is the second method where we will go with delete job. And client has to send us job name and job group. So by using job name and job group, we'll create job key. And then by using job key, we'll just delete the job from the scheduler. Okay. Now the second thing is, but before deleting, you have to make sure that job name exists into your scheduler or the reference table, so that you will get it from this data. Anyway, I'm going to showcase you. Another thing is, when you are going to delete your job from the scheduler, then you have to delete that from the job detail from the reference table as well. And that's what I am doing. So by using job name, again, job name is a unique field. So you always try to create your job with a unique field only. So the job name always needs to be unique. That you have to make sure. Okay. Along with, yeah, so trigger name can be same as job name, but always make it unique. So that's okay. So now what we are doing is, by using job name, we are fetching scheduled info, and then if scheduled info is not null, then we are simply deleting that scheduled info. So that's what we are doing in delete job. Okay, now let's create some API to find all job and to get also to delete the job. So go for REST controller here. So this will be a get mapping, and we don't need anything in this case. Response entity schedule, and here we will send list of scheduled info. Find all jobs, and this we have to go for control 1, assign to a okay. We are done with get mapping. Now let's go for delete mapping. Delete mapping schedule. Here, someone has to send the job name and the job group. So either you can ask them to send in body, or you can ask them to send in URI also. So let's go with URI. So what we'll do is job name class job group. Done. So here at path variable and string job name, job group. Okay, now what we'll do is we'll just make a call to, in this case we will send the void nothing, the capital, and delete job, job name and job group. No content we will send this case. Okay. So we are all set with all three API. One is to save the schedule, another is to find all the schedule, and the third is to delete the schedule. Okay. So what we'll do is let's check it out how it works. So come to first is let's start this container or a Spring Boot application. Come to Postman. Okay. So what we'll do now is let's go for 1524 and job 1 group 1 at 200. This is good. Job is saved. You can see that into H2 database. Okay, it is there. Now 1525, one job, and make it job 2 and just send it. Now we'll have 2. So we have 2. Again go for scheduled info, there also we'll have 2. The start time is 1524 and 1525. Okay, now again let's go for 1526, and this should be job 3. So we'll have right now 3. So just now one executed. So you can see Apple count 8, orange count, and then there is a cleanup. So now we'll have only 2. So only 2. The next will execute at 325. So let's say we want to delete this guy at 326. So what we'll do is we'll go to Postman, and here we'll go for delete mapping and schedule class job name. So job name is job 3 and the group name is group 1, and let's go for that. So we got a response, good response. So now let's go for this row must be deleted. So only one is there. If you will go for, so only one is there, so call trigger also. So now it is must have been completed by this time. So right now nothing is there because it got executed at 3:25. So we have seen that how to save, how to delete. Now go for get and simply try to get all the scheduled jobs. So nothing is there right now. Let's do one thing. Let's go for post and then we are going to save some. Okay. So job 1 and timing is, let's say 3:30 p.m. 1, 2, at the same time also you can configure, so that's okay. But let's go for 31. Third will configure, which will be at 32. Just send it. Now let's go for get. We don't need body in this case. Simply send and you have all scheduled jobs. Why it is sending only one? That we have to see, because right now we have three. Right now we have 3. Why it is sending only 1? So let's go to the code. Find all jobs. Okay, this is wrong. We have to use while, but I have used wrong thing. So this thing. So let's still restart. Okay, it got restarted. Now let's fetch the detail. It is giving us all the detail. Okay, so while, actually I was using wrong condition. It has to be used while, with while. So we have seen all those options. So what I'll do is I'll just stop this service and so basically I have shown you all three things, like how to save said a job, how to delete a job, how to auto delete a job from the reference table using a listener. Now if you are very well aware and you got the idea of scheduler, then go for some of the documentation available on Spring site, also on Quad site, and then try to develop, modify, how to modify saved job. And please share the code into the comment so that I'll have a look. Also, let me know if you want me to make a video on cron job. Once again, guys, thanks a lot for going through the video and try to understand. It is very much needed nowadays to implement scheduler into your application. Sometimes due to complexity, we are not implementing, but by using this false scheduler, which is extremely easy to use with the help of Spring Boot, you are always feel very comfortable and convenient to use this API. So all the best, guys, and I'll connect to you in my next video. Once again, thank you. Stay connected. Stay well. Thank you.